This is Pastor Emery. There are three radio broadcasts reproduced on this tape. During the broadcast, you will hear me offer free monthly literature, and I will state the month. Please do not write for that literature packet as such. You may be hearing these tapes months, even years, after the original broadcast was made. Thank you. This is Pastor Emery. Proverbs 22 and verse 7 says, "The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender." Today will be broadcast number one in a series titled, "The Money Changers." I'll be talking about borrowers and lenders. If you are either, you should listen. In almost every poll where American citizens are asked what they believe is America's greatest problem, the majority answer, inflation. The money changers, we call them bankers, then announce, "We will fight that inflation by raising your cost of borrowing money." Since the majority of you people are borrowers rather than lenders, those higher interest rates raise all of your costs, forcing you to raise your prices or your wages, and we have more inflation. It should be obvious to anyone with an IQ of over 50 that high interest rates not only do not fight inflation, but that high interest rates are the most direct and the major cause of inflation. Yet millions of you, most of you with IQs over 50, actually believe the money changers, the bankers, when they say they are fighting inflation by charging you more for their money. The Bible prohibits usury on money. Is it possible we are not only being robbed by usury, but that we are blind to the method of the robbery because we are violating God's holy laws? I believe it is so. Stay tuned for broadcast number one on the money changers.
Power and works of God will lead America to read, believe, and obey Christ's holy commands. We pray that these Bible teaching programs will be used of God to that end. During the broadcast, Pastor Emery will be offering literature, which you may request for your personal study. America's Promise Radio Bible Studies are sponsored by Lord's Covenant Church of Phoenix, Arizona. Won't you join us, please? And now, Pastor Sheldon Emery.
Thank you. In Hosea 4 and verse 6, God says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." We'll read the rest of that verse later and see what knowledge is missing in our people, the lack of which is destroying them. The December 29, 1980 U.S. News and World Report gave the results on page 89 of a poll taken by the Advertising Council. The question was, who is most responsible for inflation, the government, business, labor, or consumers? Of course, the people laid the blame on all of them. However, the one group primarily responsible for what we call inflation was very carefully left completely out of the question. That is, the moneylenders. Although the interest rates on money have gone up about 100% in the last 18 months, the people were given the choice of blaming only the government, businessmen, workers, or consumers for inflation. The money-lending industry, whose raises in the cost of money affects all other costs of all other industries, that industry was left out entirely in the question. Like the magician or the sleight-of-hand artist, the pollster got the people all to look at someone else to take their eyes off the real culprits, the moneylenders. This is a very common ploy used by the so-called economic writers in our major newspapers and magazines. They write column after column of statistics and postulates about the causes of inflation and the measures which must be taken to fight it. Seldom, if ever, do they point the finger at the one true cause, the hundreds of billions of dollars in usury taken out of the productive economy each year by the moneylenders we call bankers. Most of the so-called economic experts actually attempt to convince you that when the auto manufacturer or the labor union raise their prices or wages, that causes inflation. But if the moneylender raises his prices, that reduces inflation. God Almighty said in Isaiah 5 and verse 20, "Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness." Usury is evil, yet they call it good. Some men in industry, however, do recognize that high interest rates on money is the major cause of any reduction in manufacturing and in layoffs which cause unemployment. Here are some statements by businessmen about the present high interest rates. Paul Butcher, owner of Butcher Lakefield Lumber Company in Weston, West Virginia, quote, "Small businesses haven't a prayer with today's interest rates. There is no way they can borrow money and pay it back with the small percentage of profits they make," end of quote. Lone Star Industries of Greenwich, Connecticut, ran a paid ad in their local paper, which said, among other things, quote, "The interest rate policy of the Federal Reserve System is dragging the economy of the United States into self-destruction," end of quote. That businessman had to buy space in the paper to tell his customers that simple truth. Michael Sumachast, chief economist of the National Association of Home Builders, said, quote, "All information we are getting shows that the housing industry is simply being strangled by high interest rates," end of quote. Mr. Sumachast knows that it is the high interest rates which are the cause of the high prices of homes and the subsequent inability of individuals to purchase them. Jack Oliver, general manager of Bordray Ford in Atlanta, Georgia, said, quote, "If the high rate of interest lasts 9 months to a year, it would be disastrous for the automobile industry," end of quote. The same article that carried his words said that new car dealers are now being forced to pay as much as 2% interest per month, that is 24% per year, on the cars in their showrooms. The interest alone would be between $120 and $150 per month on each car from the time the dealer buys it from the factory until he delivers it to the customer. If he has the car for more than 6 months, and many of them are there that long, the bank would get $600 to $800 from that one car before it ever turned a wheel on the highway. The dealer must, of course, add that to the price of the car or risk going out of business, and many of them are not able to get those prices and are going out of business. In the first 9 months of 1980, 1,643 auto dealerships closed their doors. Automakers estimate another 1,200 will be closed by March of 1981. If that happens, that will mean as many as 25% of all new auto dealers in America will have closed down between January of 1980 and March of 1981. All during this time, of course, the Federal Reserve Chairman keeps saying, "We've got to raise interest rates to fight inflation," and most people cannot see that he is lying. I mentioned at the beginning that God Almighty forbids the charging or collecting of usury on debts in the first place, and I want to read that from the Bible and have you read it with me. So before we go on about the bankers, I will offer our free packet of literature on this subject, and while I am doing that, you can get your Bibles to follow with me. I am calling this Money Packet Number 1. The packet will include a number of items on this subject, the major one being a 32-page booklet I wrote titled Billions for the Bankers, Debts for the People. These 32 pages explain how the bankers, through usury on trillions of dollars in loans, bleed off from the American economy a tremendous amount of all wealth production for their own use. I'll be reading excerpts from this on this radio series, but you should have the entire booklet to read yourself. Write to America's Promise, Box 5334, Phoenix, Arizona, 85010. Ask for Money Packet Number 1. An example of how this booklet will open the eyes of our confused people is this letter I recently received from an Episcopal priest. He writes, "Dear Pastor Emery, I have just read your booklet, Billions for the Bankers, Debts for the People, and want to thank you for a beautiful piece of writing, especially your presentation to Congress urging an audit of the Federal Reserve System. That was a masterpiece. I should insert here, I have reprinted in the booklet my testimony to a committee of Congress about the auditing of the Federal Reserve System." That was several years ago. The Episcopal priest goes on, quote, "Please send 20 copies of the pamphlet as soon as possible. In college, there was only one academic subject that I could not make any sense out of, economics. And now, for the first time, I know why. It really didn't make any sense. Theologians apparently don't have a corner on the market in clouding the issues with mysterious and bewildering nonsense under the guise of deep mystery. I stumbled on this business, by the way, quite by accident. A friend happened to play a tape by John Todd, which I began to follow up in various ways. Your pamphlet was sent to me as a result of an inquiry to Pat Brooks about her book, The Return of the Puritans. And then he tells this little story. A group of us once played a game in which we were blindfolded, put in a ring with cardboard boxes, and told to build a castle out of them. It was a test of our ability to work together. Unknown to us, there were others who were taking the boxes apart as fast as we put them together. We began to suspect that something was wrong somewhere along the line, but none of us guessed the truth. Later, of course, we were told. I feel that I am just getting the blinders taken off in politics and economics also. No wonder nothing has been able to work. The powers that be were making sure it didn't. Thanks for taking the blinders off me. And he signs it, faithfully in Christ, and then his name. Over the last several years, I have had hundreds of very similar letters from people in all walks of life saying much the same thing. Pastor Emery, I never really understood why our economic system made debtors of the whole nation in spite of the fact we produce so much wealth. Now, after reading your booklet, Billions for the Bankers, Debts for the People, I understand. So you write me and ask for the free literature. Just ask for Money Packet Number 1, Billions for the Bankers, Debts for the People, will be in that packet. My address again, America's Promise, Box 5334, Phoenix, Arizona, 85010. That's Box 5334, Phoenix, Arizona, 85010. All right, do you have your Bibles? I am going to read the law on usury out of the law that God gave to our Israel fathers at Mount Sinai in the wilderness. And I know in advance, some of my listeners will say, oh, that is the old covenant. Those laws have all been put away. We are under the new covenant now, not the old. All right, I'll answer that objection before I read this law out of the old covenant. What is the new covenant? What is it supposed to do? Here it is from the New Testament, Hebrews 8, verse 10 and 11. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. Now, what laws are these which will be written in your hearts and minds with the new covenant? Will it be some new laws that God will make up at some time in the future? No, there is no indication of that at all. When God says, My laws, he means, quite simply, the laws already given to his people at Mount Sinai in the wilderness. These were the laws they disobeyed, and for which disobedience they were punished, just as we today are being punished or judged by God Almighty for our disobedience to those same laws. So to see what the laws are, the laws which are to be written in our hearts and in our minds by the new covenant, we must turn to the only book in the world where they are recorded, specifically the Old Testament in the Bible. So let's go back to Mount Sinai. We'll find the law covenant recorded in the Old Testament in Exodus 20, 21, 22, and 23. Then these laws are explained and elaborated at greater length through Moses in the rest of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy in the books called the Books of the Law. Since we are here interested in the laws on money and debt, specifically on usury, let's read that portion in Exodus 22, and it's in verse 25. If thou lend money to any of my people that is poor by thee, thou shalt not be to him as an usurer, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. And I'll explain the meaning of usury as we go along. Now turn to Leviticus 25, verse 35. And if thy brother be waxen poor and fallen in decay with thee, then thou shalt relieve him. The margin there says an alternate translation could be, thou shalt strengthen him, yea, though he be a stranger or a sojourner, that he may live with thee. So we are commanded to help the poor, And then it goes on, verse 36 and verse 37, take thou no usury of him or increase, but fear thy God, that thy brother may live with thee. Thou shalt not give him thy money upon usury, nor lend him thy victuals for increase. That, of course, makes it plainer what usury is, for here the phrase is added, or increase. Usury is anything above the original amount, any increase. Now turn to Deuteronomy 23, where this is again repeated, but here another thought is added, that God Almighty cannot bless the Israelites if they charge usury. Deuteronomy 23, beginning in verse 19. Thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother, usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury. This brings in everything, and you wouldn't think of lending your neighbor your wheelbarrow and then demanding 1 1/2 wheelbarrows when he returns it. However, you've been conditioned by anti-Bible propaganda to think that it is all right for people to lend money and then demand back more than the original amount lent. Thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother, usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury. Verse 20, unto a stranger thou mayest lend upon usury, but unto thy brother thou shalt not lend upon usury. And listen to this, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all that thou settest thine hand to in the land whither thou goest to possess it. Now, I don't know whether you can see the momentous principle stated there by God Almighty. Let me paraphrase it, and you read it again and see if this is right. God Almighty said, in effect, in order for me to bless you in the land you go to possess, you must refrain from charging your fellow Israelites usury on debts. The other side of that coin would therefore read, if you do charge usury of fellow Israelites, then I, God Almighty, cannot bless you. Now, you keep that in mind as we continue with this study, for there is much more in both the Law and the Prophets, and in the New Testament, which I will get into later, which will verify that one of the major reasons God Almighty is not blessing America today, but is instead bringing down His judgment upon us, is the massive usury or increase we allow to be charged our fellow Israelites in our money lending and creation of debt upon them. And it is the bankers or the money changers who are violating that statute of God Almighty, and they are doing it not only with our permission, but with our protection. We even provide the sheriff and other law officers to go out and physically evict or drive out the homeowner, the farmer, or the businessman who cannot pay the usury on his loan to the banker. Then we provide the judges and the courts who give the title to that house, that farm, or that factory to the banker. Yes, the bankers are violating the law of God. However, they are doing it with our blessing and approval. We therefore, as a people and as a nation, become sinners right along with them. The Apostle John gave us a principle in 2 John verse 10 and 11, that if we bid Godspeed to anyone who does not hold to the true doctrines of our God, then we become partakers of his evil deeds. Charging usury on money and debts is not the doctrines of our God, for our God forbids it in his law. Therefore, when we aid and abet the violation of God's law, then we are guilty, right along with the bankers before God Almighty. So you folks who may have been wondering why this radio preacher is preaching about money and debt and usury, and what did that have to do with the Christian gospel, now you can see. Our economic system violates God's laws. So what we have is not just an economic problem, we have a sin problem, and ministers should be dealing with it. Now I realize that many of my listeners will not entirely agree with me regarding interest being usury, and therefore being a sin. Many of you have been taught, and you sincerely believe, that usury means exorbitant interest, or interest above that which the law allows, and by that you mean the law of our government. However, even there, up until about 20 years ago, any interest above 6% was considered usury and was punishable by a fine and a prison sentence placed upon the usurer by the government. I was a real estate salesman for many years before I went into the ministry, and I sold a lot of houses in the 1950s with mortgages at 4% interest, later many with 5%. The bankers were making enough money at those rates at that time so that they were buying up the valuable downtown properties, they were purchasing stocks in major corporations, and they were building massive skyscrapers in all major American cities. Now, if they could do that with 4% and 5%, what do you suppose they are doing with their money when they are getting 10% and 15% and 20% and even 30% on short-term loans? Perhaps you will agree with me that 15% interest is usury, but I remind you that almost all state legislatures have recently changed their laws. They have either raised the usury level or they have removed it altogether, so that no matter what the bankers charge, it is not usury under state or government laws. I would also remind you that state legislators neither make nor amend the laws of God Almighty. God has made those laws, and God's laws stand. And whatever was usury when God gave the law at Sinai is usury today, state legislators and bankers notwithstanding. It therefore follows that violation of God's law is a sin, even if there is no penalty in man's law for that violation. Our Christian forefathers of past centuries understood the law of God much better than we do. In England, for over 1,000 years after Christ, anyone who lent money or charged any interest at all was subject to punishment as a criminal. The level of punishment varied at different times. At some times it was execution. At other times it was confiscation of all property and exile from England. Here is a quote on bankers and usury from Martin Luther, one of the greatest Christian reformers of our race. Quote, "The heathen, out of natural reason and understanding, were able to render an account that an usurer is a threefold thief and murderer. But we that are Christians hold them in such honor and esteem that in a manner we adore and worship them. No regard is had what scorn and derision thereby we procure to the name of a Christian and to Christ himself. For although we were not Christians, yet natural sense and reason tells us that an usurer is a murderer. For whoso sucks the maintenance of another, the same not only robs and steals, but also he commits even as great a murder as he that starves and utterly destroys one. This does an usurer, and in the meantime sits in his chair, whereas he justly ought to hang on the gallows and be devoured by so many ravens as he has stolen shillings. Cato, the usurer's enemy, said, 'Little thieves lie stalked, ironed in prisons, but great thieves ride prancing in silks and chains of gold. But so much as we neither punish nor strive against them, therefore without all doubt in the end, we together with the usurers shall pay sweetly for it,'" end of quote, by Martin Luther. Even in the America of the 1700s and 1800s, the evil of usury was understood, and many Christian churches refused church membership to anyone who lent money at interest. Bankers were practically unknown in the more fundamental churches until about a century ago. Now, almost every church in America not only welcomes the usurer, but considers it a great honor to have on their membership rolls a president or owners of money-lending institutions. There are other associated laws in the Bible that have a bearing on our economic order, which we will study as I go along, and I'll show you what effect they would have on our economic problems if, and that remains the big word, if we would put them into practice. At the present time, I doubt that very much, if anything, will be done to put God's laws into effect in the land, especially since there is probably not one church in 1,000 that even teaches what God's laws are. This is Pastor Sheldon Emery. God willing, next week we will get into some of these other laws in the Bible and the prophecies, and eventually we'll get into the New Testament to show Christ's teachings on this subject. This is Pastor Emery saying goodbye. God bless you. Read your Bibles and pray for Christian America.